This pageantry cloaks the British Constitution. But what's really at its heart? Have you ever heard of parts of it called MISC 7, OD, ODSA, Gen 29, MISC 94, or the LF? What do you think they are? In some ways, these organizations are more secret than MI5 or MI6, and there are many more of them. These mysterious initials are amongst any Prime Minister's most closely guarded secrets. These are the organizations who have really decided critical national issues over the last 10 years. Issues like Russians, the problem is Britain and us. Unlike Parliament, only the Queen has a right to know how the Cabinet actually does its work, even if she doesn't always ask. But the committee system is secret from everyone else, and that often includes government ministers.
My Lords and members of the House of Commons.
So Cabinet committees are the big secret of Prime Ministerial power. That power's most vulnerable, but most critical, at the time of a general election. In the last two elections, the outgoing governments used such committees for unusual tactics, which, like details of the committees themselves, have no place in the textbooks that are supposed to teach us about the British Constitution.
The way it's taught is a combination of two things, magic and probity. The British Constitution is taught as a secret garden because it's not written down, and yet it's something magnificent. Probity is always stressed because it's accountability first and foremost. Civil servants are accountable to ministers, ministers are accountable to Parliament, and above all, the Prime Minister is accountable twice a week in the House of Commons. This is why it is claimed always, and it's now a cliché, Watergate could not happen in this country. The reality is rather different. The reality is such that these neat lines of command break down routinely.
Chris Price tried to get the last Labour government to open up its cabinet committees.
All secret committees are set up on the Prime Minister's own authority. There are certain cabinet committees which are what you might call run-of-the-mill cabinet committees, which, though not public, are almost semi-public.
Even cabinet ministers don't necessarily know who's on what committee.
Oh, no, you can sit in the cabinet and feel totally disfranchised. I remember one of Mrs. Thatcher's ministers saying to me, you're always banging on about open government, more open government. She doesn't believe in open government for us, let alone people like you.
The last Labour government promised freedom of information laws to
place the burden on the public authorities to justify withholding information.
Freedom of information bill, those in favour. Thank you. Anybody against?
But Labour's prime ministers weren't so keen to put that promise into practice. So Jim Callaghan set up a cabinet committee to look into official secrecy.
I am absolutely certain that Jim Callaghan was prevaricating between 1974 and 1979, because I was told later that a secret cabinet committee had been set up in order to prevaricate.
It's called Gen 29, which is Cabinet Office gobbledygook for the 29th ad hoc committee created since Mr. Callaghan became Prime Minister.
And presumably it was also a secret?
Oh, totally, yes.
And its membership?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I mean, again, with complete lack of self-irony, Labour ministers, progressive to the last man and woman, go along with this nonsense whereby these committees do not exist. It's as if the decisions come out of the ether, as if they hear the voices like Joan of Arc.
But Jim Callaghan certainly wasn't going to bring openness to the cabinet committee system. In fact, Gen 29's plan was really to toughen the Official Secrets Act. A bill to do this had already been written, but they'd never dared to publish it.
Further proposals will be brought forward to achieve more open government. It remains my government's intention to replace Section 2 of the Official Secrets Act 1911 with a measure better suited to present-day conditions.
What that really meant was that Mr. Callaghan wasn't going to legislate, of course, just air some proposals in order to delay the whole thing. He didn't like the idea of open government one little bit. But he was suddenly put on the
pose. You know, it was four subjunctives and two negatives.
When detailed discussions on the bill began, a Home Office minister, Blinmore John, tried to alter Freud's bill to conform with what Gen 29 had wanted all along.
Well, he was obviously very well briefed, and there were a lot of amendments which, had he not been the minister, one would have called wrecking amendments.
What would you call them?
Wrecking amendments. It was a fairly eviscerated official information bill that came out of committee. Most of the clauses had been tampered with, and instead of shall, we had might, and instead of will, we had where possible, should attempt to, that sort of thing.
Meanwhile, Labour's grip on power was being eroded. Dustmen and lorry drivers were out on long strikes. The start of 1979 was the so-called winter of discontent. The Lib-Lab Pact, which had held Jim Callaghan securely in power, was beginning to fall apart.
No encouragement to pursue that line at all. He was against it that much. He was trying to do deals on devolution, on one thing and another. And Mr. Callaghan was very flexible in wanting to hold on to power over his political career. But on this, freedom of information, he had a very massive sticking point.
Early in the year, Chris Price, with other MPs and Floyd's advisers, started negotiating with civil servants over details of the bill. But the government wasn't willing to give ground. They were trying to turn it round, to strengthen secrecy instead. Wednesday, 28th of March, 1979. In just 9 days, Floyd's bill had faced its critical report stage. But Labour ministers faced a vote of confidence at 10 o'clock that very night. Liberal MPs would be voting with the opposition, and Labour would have no overall majority. One Labour MP was seriously ill, so the government would be in a minority of one, and doomed. If one Labour MP had to be missing, perhaps an opposing MP could go missing too. All the participants in what happened next have never together told their stories until now.
Everybody was changing their mind as defeat stared them in the face. On the day Labour was facing a vote of confidence, and the votes were being secretly added up, and it looked as though Labour was losing by one, I was approached by the Chief Whip and told that if I could save the day by getting Clement Freud to miss his train from Liverpool, Clement Freud could have his bill passed into law.
Liberal candidate David Alton was campaigning with Freud in a local by-election. Freud had...
I said, who is it? And they said it was the Prime Minister's office. And also the people in Littlewoods were enormously impressed with this. And I went to the office as if the Prime Minister phones me a lot. And then there was sort of talk about, is this a secure line? And is nobody listening? And so I told the man to go away. And it was Chris Price. And he said, I'm speaking to you from number 10 Downing Street. And you can have your bill, provided you miss your train.
Well, I told Clement Freud that I wasn't just speaking in my capacity as an MP. I was speaking because the Chief Whip had called me. I assumed that that was on the full authority of the Prime Minister, and all he had to do was to miss his train to London. He didn't have to do anything more than that, and if he wanted to make it look like an accident, he could do that.
I was in Liverpool. The vote was at 10 o'clock. This was 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And I suppose I was helped in this by this coming as a bolt from the blue. I mean, I had no idea that they were even thinking about this.
He said he'd think about it. I think it was a great shock to him. I don't think he was used to wheeling and dealing in government as some other MPs and politicians. And I think the problem was he was incredulous. He wasn't certain whether Labour would have delivered.
And what was I going to get as an official information bill? Some other useless, loose piece of legislation which wouldn't have been what I was on about. There was I mean, the country waiting for a new government. And there was I, actually by a negative act of missing a train.
Freud had 2 hours to decide. Would it be the deal with Callaghan and freedom of information for Britain, or no deal, take a risk, and wait to see what the future might have in store?
I didn't know. I was sitting on the Labour benches hoping that Freud was still in Liverpool. And as people filed out of the lobbies, and there was no Freud, no Freud, no Freud, my heart rose. Then right at the end, as the last people came out of the lobby, I saw him and I felt, crikey, I've lost that one and we've probably lost.
Got the train, had dinner, was bullied into going to the House of Commons even earlier than I would have done, appeared, voted against the government, and the government fell by one vote.
How did you feel being forced a few hours, the
manipulating.
How did you feel the fate of the government of Britain was in your hands alone?
I felt a sort of moral indignation that I should be brought into this. It's really very odd that having covertly opposed my bill as they did, they should then, for the doubtful advantage of governing for a few more months, which is all they had anyway, offer to do something which they said they wouldn't do.
Mr. Callaghan's furniture was soon being carted out of number 10 by the back door. Would the new tenant be willing to make cabinet decision-taking more open to the public?
Where there is doubt, may we bring faith. And where there is despair, may we bring hope.
Mrs. Thatcher is marvellous on the liberty of the individual, except when it comes to the right to know. That is missing from her pantheon. She's an exceedingly authoritarian lady when it comes to confidentiality of government operations and government paper. She has syringed the collective nature, the collective marrow from cabinet and cabinet committee work into informal ad hoc groups which she can stack to get the result she desires.
But Mrs. Thatcher's also used the traditional method of setting up formal cabinet subcommittees.
One of these was the replacement of the Polaris strategic nuclear deterrent force with something else. And this was put into a cabinet committee known as MISC 7, which in our language, normal language, is the seventh ad hoc committee Mrs. Thatcher created after becoming Prime Minister.
MISC meaning?
Miscellaneous.
And was this committee a secret?
Totally.
The decision by the MISC 7 cabinet committee to replace Polaris with Trident was soon followed by permission to station US cruise missiles in Britain. The two decisions provoked immediate protests. After years in the political wilderness, the campaign for nuclear disarmament now found themselves at the centre of the political stage. Opinion polls showed a majority in Britain were opposed to Trident and Cruise. The government's popularity slumped. At the same time, CND's membership blossomed. Conservative Party managers feared the whole defence issue could lose them the next election unless they took urgent steps to turn the tide of public opinion. What happened next? A campaign against CND led to a remarkable catalogue of Whitehall improprieties. One group broke the law. Government and foreign money was channeled into other groups. And the government itself was accused of improperly involving civil servants in party politics. The campaign against unilateral disarmament operated at three levels: the government, the Conservative Party, and sympathetic outside organisations. On the government side, the secret cabinet committee, MISC 7, led on to a special subcommittee called the Ministerial Group on Nuclear Weapons and Public Opinion. The subcommittee was chaired by Defence Minister Peter Blaker, backed up by junior ministers from the Home Office and Foreign Office. Defence advice, like the film Protect and Survive, had been a political disaster. Instead of reassuring people, it made them more worried about nuclear war. A 1980 civil defence exercise, Square Leg, had shown graphically how Britain would fare under nuclear attack. With 130 nuclear weapons used, not a lot would be left. So ministers like Peter Blaker and Home Office Civil Defence Minister Patrick Mayhew were worried about where the bombs might land in the next exercise due in 1982. So in hard rock, less than 50 bombs would fall in Britain. Most British and American military bases would be excluded from the hit list in case local residents became nervous about being in the firing line. As far as possible, bombs shouldn't be targeted on major cities, and if they were, they should miss. But this meant nuclear weapons would have to land in some unlikely places. Mallaig in the northwest of Scotland, a remote fishing village with a population of less than 1,000, and mountains in the middle of Wales with no population at all to worry about. But the new target map still wasn't quite what ministers wanted. So they asked civil servants to list the parliamentary constituency in which each bomb would land, and decided it would be unwise for bombs to land on any marginal constituency. They'd have to retarget these bombs too. The Cairngorm Mountains now became a prime target as more bombs were moved away from populated areas. But with all these changes, the whole exercise was by now so unrealistic that it had to be cancelled by the Home Secretary, who blamed opposition from nuclear-free local authorities. There's never been a national civil defence exercise since. That was the government's first contribution to the campaign to win public opinion away from the peace movement. At the same time, the Conservative Party set up a special committee of their own, the Campaign for Peace Through Freedom, chaired by MP Winston Churchill. Piers Woolley was a Tory Party official who worked for the new committee.
Well, at Winston Churchill's meetings, the Campaign for Peace Through Freedom was an umbrella organisation set up to coordinate the activities of the British Atlantic Committee, BAC, the Coalition for Peace Through Security, the CPS.
These two organisations, the British Atlantic Committee and the Coalition for Peace Parties. The government now decided to increase their funding of BAC to help the committee to get the message across to the public. But the message was now an all-out attack on CND. BAC's government grant was nearly trebled to £58,000. But as a registered charity, the committee wasn't supposed to get involved in political campaigning.
Ken Aldred, who was BAC's representative on the Winston Churchill Committee, had reported back to BAC itself, the organisation, with Alan Lee Williams, that they were sailing pretty close to the concept of charitable status by taking a political stand on nuclear disarmament.
And after receiving complaints, the charity commissioner said yes, BAC had stepped over the line. Soon after that, the British Atlantic Committee pulled out of Winston Churchill's group when they heard about the unorthodox activities of one of the other groups represented, the Coalition for Peace Through Security. The Coalition was anything but a respected all-party organisation. It was run by three Conservative parliamentary candidates and an American businessman. The Coalition specialised in trying to disrupt CND events. It was backed by a foreign right-wing pressure group, the Heritage Foundation of Washington. Letters exist showing that the Heritage Foundation provided at least $60,000 to support the Coalition's noisy opposition to CND.
These were the streetwise kids, if you like. They were mainly involved with heckling at public meetings.
CND demonstrations. The Coalition frequently flew provocative banners low over the crowds. During 1982, their pilot was convicted of illegal and dangerous low-flying at one CND festival. But that didn't stop them. Nor did the Coalition confine its activities to Britain. Two of their activists went to the United States to disrupt a speaking tour by Bruce Kent, then CND's General Secretary.
Well, the standard technique of papering over advertisements for meetings so that as far as most people were concerned, the venue had then been changed so that anyone interested in listening to Bruce Kent would turn up at the wrong meeting hall.
My experience generally with the Coalition has been one of outrage on my part. I mean, I just didn't know people behaved like this in public life. I mean, I think that I can't imagine an organisation behaving in a more disgraceful way in a society more democratic than most.
The Coalition also produced leaflets, distributed for them by the Conservative Party, just part of a great volume of material flooding out from a variety of organisations. The biggest contribution of all came from the Ministry of Defence, which could draw on an annual information budget of £16 million. This was one of the Defence Ministry's more memorable contributions to the campaign, the British Bulldog facing up to a bullying bear.
The Prime Minister herself was very enthusiastic about it, even though she had slight problems about what colour the bear was. But apart from that little problem, there was quite a lot of enthusiasm for the pamphlet.
How did she show her enthusiasm?
By banging the table and repeating that we've got to use that bear.
Senior Defence Ministry civil servants were a little less keen.
I think it was a bit more extrovert than the normal staff that, you know, comes out of government departments, which is pretty stodgy on the whole. And I think certainly that leaflet was viewed as sort of slightly way out.
The Prime Minister set up a series of Conservative Party liaison committees to plan the party's election stand on critical issues. The meetings took place in the Cabinet Room of Number 10. But these were party political committees. The secretariat consisted of Conservative Party officials, not civil servants. There's a long-established convention in Whitehall that civil servants should not be seen to participate in party political occasions.
I think it would be very unusual for any civil servant to attend a gathering of that nature, which, by definition, must be a party political occasion.
It became known that Ingham had had an active role in the Conservatives' Liaison Committee on Defence. Eyebrows were raised.
And very properly in Whitehall, the old sweats, who really do believe in keeping the distinction between appointed officials or permanent civil servants and elected people who serve the transient government of the day, and this was regarded as anathema.
At the start of 1983, Michael Heseltine had taken over at the Ministry of Defence. Observers reckoned there were two reasons for his appointment.
One is to make it more efficient, and he's good at that, likes management, which is very rare for a minister. The other one was to thump CND's, a very successful
servant. ..and of leading CND officers.
I was again shocked. I mean, I just didn't realise that people who look so respectable in public will behave in such ways if they want political power. I mean, Heseltine has never smears the council of CND. He gets it wrong because he implies that there are 26 members of our council. There are actually over 100 because of the regional delegations coming, so he doesn't even get the proportions right.
I don't think anybody had any illusions about what the purposes of DS19 were.
So, in the 2 years preceding the 1983 election, an extraordinary number and range of organisations had set about the task of winning public opinion over to the government's cause. Bodies ranging from the wilder fringes, like the Coalition for Peace Through Security, to the Defence Ministry's own DS19. Their campaign worked.
It was supremely successful in making CND's membership, senior membership, the issue, rather than the issue of unilateral disarmament.
No, the main purpose was to win the election. And that is why the nature of the campaign was information, disinformation, and on many occasions, character assassination.
I think any government at the end of a second term is paranoid. By this stage, even the most balanced prime minister thinks the world is agin him or her. So there could be an even greater emphasis on massaging the media and all the rest of it.
After this year's party conferences, it became apparent that defence, once again, would be one of the issues at the heart of the next general election.
I would, if necessary, fight and die. Fight and lay down my life for my country and what it stands for. I would die for my country, but I tell you,
we had union in 40 years, and they would have got it without firing a shot.
There's a new Conservative committee to campaign against Labour and Alliance defence policies. And just as before the last election, there's a new government film on the Conservative Party's defence policy. And the secret committees of 1987, we might officially hear about them in...
If you're a cabinet minister and you have to put up with difficult backbenchers and far from deferential press, a public opinion that does never understand the virtue of your case, the one compensation is going home late at night and breaking open the fourth red box that your private office has provided and seeing something from the Defence and Overseas Policy Committee of the Cabinet with top secret on it that only you and 12 other people know. It's one of the great compensations for an otherwise unbearable life.
It is odd, isn't it, how people have in street.
Politicians in opposition are happy to proclaim their commitment to openness. But once in power, it's a quite different story. Then, so it seems, the less we know, the more they like it. And governments of every denomination have been only too ready to go along with Whitehall's obsession that those who run Britain should remain a secret society.